I'm Trisha Kelly. This is Tom Kelly. Tonight we have a dear friend and also someone who offers something very special to our yoga community in Southern California. Welcome, Laura Plum.
Thank you.
Now, of course, we can cross-reference this a little bit. If you've seen our show with Baba Ram, this is her husband. Baba's her husband. And Laura and Baba actually got married here at the Soul Center.
We did. Very special.
From Night of the Meadow.
Yeah.
So, now I don't know where to start. We've got Jyotish astrology and Ayurveda and the work that you do at ginseng with Baba and deep yoga, and we also have then the work that you're doing with women. But I'm intrigued. Tell us the story about the two teachers who sort of guided you toward what they saw to be your vision or your work here on the planet.
Well, I shared that with you a little earlier because, and I really don't share it with people except that. No, it's okay.
You got the scoop.
It's okay. But I share it with people when I feel that these teachers would have said it about you too. That I feel that perhaps we knew each other once when we were all living along the great holy rivers that flowed from the top of the Himalayas, bringing heaven's grace down, you know, on its back. So there was the Saraswati River, one of the three great rivers that flowed from heaven. And the Saraswati now, it's proven that the Saraswati still actually exists. It's an underground river now. But along the Saraswati River, which was a great, huge river, grew up this really rich, abundant civilization. And at the time, there was the worship was of the Divine Mother, of the Devi. And yoga was known, and Ayurveda was the practicing medicine. And because of the great river, the valleys were very fertile. People not only had all the food that they needed, they had all the medicine that they needed, because medicine grows from the ground. And they had abundance. They could take their extra food to the market. And so people had time. They had a little bit of extra time on their hands. And some clever people took that time and sat quietly and observed the beauty of nature. And so out of this arose a great civilization with high arts and beauty everywhere. And according to archaeologists, they're showing that it was a very egalitarian society, that people had indoor plumbing, people had, you know, simple, modest homes, but everybody had a nice home, and that everybody lived in a very connected way. And so one of my Jyotish teachers, looking at my own chart, Jyotish is Vedic astrology, looked at the chart and said, "It's clear to me that you are here, born alive, to help remember the Saraswati culture and to help rebirth it now here in the West." And what he was really saying by that is to remember the Devi and to cultivate the sacred feminine in our daily lives. And of course, I think the sacred feminine's always been with us. It's just really that divine remembrance. So,
and Divine Mother is a very important time, I think, as we all know, to bring that balance. It's been often, many people have thought that it's the imbalance that is within us and around us that has created sort of the chaos that we have grown, that we're healing.
I'm glad to hear you say that. I think of you as a great Devi, that's why, and I think of both of you, both carry the Divine Mother's energy so powerfully.
And he's got a mother's, we always say he's got a mother's heart.
He does have a mother's heart. And you can just feel when you're with Tom how much the mother loves him.
Yes,
he's a favorite son. Yes, right. Absolutely. Uh-huh. It's so true. But what you said about balance is so key, and that's what's led me to start the Sophia Mission and the Sophia Circles and the Sophia work that I do. Because what we know through Ayurveda, if there's one word that describes Ayurveda, is balance. The key to healing is balance. Once we have balance in the physical or mental body, then healing can occur. Until we have balance, no healing will occur. But once we have balance, healing occurs. So, of course, Ayurvedic medicine is all about bringing ourselves back into balance. So I looked at that and I said, well, if that's the case, then if we could balance divine masculine, divine feminine, in human culture, healing would occur. So rather than chasing all the suffering, trying to feed the hungry and, you know, house the homeless mm-hmm. and all these, you know, problems we see and conflicts in the world, rather than, you know, having our heart tugged in all these directions saying, where do we put our energy? If we could put our energy into really cultivating the sacred feminine, both men and women alike, then we would have balance. And healing would spontaneously occur. Mm-hmm. And we don't have to feel personally responsible. We just be responsible for cultivating that in our own selves. Mm-hmm. And it will happen everywhere. Because the other principle of yoga, yata, pinde, tata, brahmande, in the smallest thing is the everything. You know, in the atom is the all. You know, in each cell is the cosmos. So that we're all mirrors of the whole world. Mm-hmm. You know, we all have all five elements. We all began in the furnace in the belly of a star. And every aspect that's in a star in the cosmos is within us. Mm-hmm. So heal yourself, bring balance to the self. It makes sense, you heal the world. So that's really what my work is with supporting cultures that cultivate the divine feminine. Mm. And hosting circles and conferences where women can come together and really discuss what that means for them in their own life, how we can heal ourselves and that wound to the feminine in order to be a healing force for the world.
Mm. Is that what the Sophia mission is about?
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah, yeah.
Now you've been asked to present something very special at the Shakti Fest.
Right.
About that.
So Shakti Fest is the spring version of Bhakti Fest. And they asked both Bhava and me to come and teach. And we'll do a couple of classes, but then they specifically asked me if I would do a workshop on, they just said Shakti, Ayurveda. And then they saw that I make oils. I make Ayurvedic oils with herbs and things. So she said, and maybe you could do something on oils. And so when I did a little meditation on that, I thought, well, the word for oils, or oil massage in Ayurveda is snehana, which means love. So when you're oiling your body or you're getting a full body warm oil massage from Ayurvedic practitioners, what you're getting is mother's love in a very hands-on, tangible, applicable way. So I thought, well, maybe what I could teach, and include the oils, but I could teach something about Shakti as the first medicine woman and, you know, divine mother as healer. So that's what I'm going to be teaching, and basically how her, that principle of love is in the earth. I mean, the earth really is the material expression of divine mother's love. And she's loving us all the time with her beauty, her playground for us to experience delight and joy and connection. Her beauty gives us inspiration, opens our hearts, makes us happy. But most of all, she's giving us these nourishing foods all the time. Mm-hmm. And we don't even think about it. We go to a grocery store and buy packaged foods. So until we get back to that connection to the earth, and the earth not just giving us food, but think about how she, in each of her seasons, is giving us exactly the food that will balance us for what she's doing. So if in the springtime she's giving us a lot of heavy, cold water, she's going to give us foods that's hot, pungent, light, astringent, etc. In the summer when it's hot out, when she's doing hot, she gives us the food that will balance what she's doing. She gives us cooling foods. So she's always considering us. And you know, then when you think it's not just us she has to feed, it's the animals, the birds, etc. So they're getting their seeds and they're getting their foods while we're getting ours. She's got a lot to think about. Mm. But she's always taking care of us, always nourishing us. Mm. That's her love. And that's her medicine. Mm. You know, because it's not just food to nourish us, but medicine to heal us. Beautiful plants, fruits. The Ayurvedic cabinetry, the pharmaceutical cabinet, is full of not just seeds and roots, but fruits and honey, you know, delicious foods. Mm. That's why I always love to sing Mary Poppins' song, and I joked about that earlier. But that song, just a spoonful of sugar will help the medicine go down. She knew that. Mother Earth knows that, you know, and it's a reminder that we are designed perfectly, Not just are we designed perfectly, but we are wanted. Yeah. She loves us. She wants us. Yeah. Not just to be alive, but to be healthy, happy, and whole. Mm. And it's really about just go outside and look at this beautiful day and remember, there's a loving presence always surrounding us.
Well, it's absolute wisdom to love the mother, love the Divine Mother. If you look at yogic philosophy and you trace it back to how they say creation began, there's, you know, the creator father energy, the divine masculine, saying, you know what, I'm going to want to divide myself so I can enjoy myself, and the
right.
and the sparks of myself can enjoy me. They're going to seem like they're separate from me, but we're really one. So he had this great idea, right?
Right.
But to show you how the divine feminine is everything in this creation, according to their scriptures, it says that then he had two consorts. And they were divine feminine. One is Ganga and the other is Satyavati. Ganga helps to bring the consciousness of the divine in every atom, as you were mentioning, the divine joy consciousness, the Ananda. And then Satyavati brings in how this material world comes to manifestation.
Mm-hmm.
And then he, the divine masculine, says, all right, see you later. The whole universe, the created universe, is in charge of these two aspects of myself, the divine feminine.
Yeah,
and then he's out playing golf somewhere.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The transcendent, beyond creation.
Yeah.
Divine masculine, and he puts in charge.
Right.
Of what you would any manifested thing in all the universe is, Divine Mother.
Right.
It's like, okay, so that's when growing up in Yogananda's tradition, when he said, if you love Divine Mother with all your heart, she wipes out your karma.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he made that his life, loving mm-hmm. Divine Mother.
Yeah.
And I thought, see, it's she's responsible also for the duality and the so-called separateness of form and all that, mm-hmm. which you could call the Maya.
Mm-hmm.
But if you get on the good side of Divine Mother,
mm-hmm.
she'll take you home.
Right.
She'll sweep
take
you up.
Take you home.
She'll
sure.
sweep you up mm-hmm. and bring you back into her arms, just like that.
I think that's why Yogananda is so lovable.
Yes.
Right?
He, I think, was fierce. You know, you listen to some of the recordings, and you hear a pitta, you hear fire. And yet, when you feel him, you feel really loving presence.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of holy monks, sages in India who became enlightened through their worship of the Divine Mother. Yeah. And that's so beautiful, too. It's that unbroken tradition of worship. You don't find that anywhere.
No.
Yeah.
They did hold that true.
Right.
Yeah. They have given that back to us. They held it. India mm-hmm. has held it for us all these thousands
right.
of years that we forgot. And
right.
now many, including Yogananda, brought it back to us.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my favorite mm-hmm. things that's just tucked in his teachings and it's easily missed when I read these words of his, I said, that's it. I want to emulate that. And he said this. He said, Divine Mother, I am thy little babe.
Yeah.
Thy helpless babe, mm-hmm. secretly sitting on your lap of immortality. I will steal my way to heaven, secreted on your lap.
Hmm.
In the shelter of your lap, I will steal my way to heaven. Can you imagine an avatar, someone with that cosmic wisdom is saying, Divine Mother, I am your helpless little babe.
Yeah.
Laying on your lap of immortality, and I'm just going to stay right there, hugged up, right?
Yeah.
And I'm going to steal my way to heaven because you're
sure.
going to bring me home.
Right.
I'm just going to surrender to you.
Right. I know it's beautiful, and these images of that fierce goddess Kali, chopping off your heads and your arms and heads, blood dripping all over her. But with her foot on Shiva, on the heart, you know, reminding us that she's going to bring us home to Shiva, to pure consciousness.
Mm.
And there's always that little baby, that little child,
mm.
right under her somewhere, right close by somewhere, reminding us too that it's to make ourselves pure like a child again, innocent like a child again.
Mm.
That's when she'll bring us home to our pure immortal self.
Mm-hmm.
I love those images.
Mm. You know, I want to ask you, maybe go back to Ayurveda and balance again, because, well, first of all, I have two questions. One, if someone happens to be watching this in Idaho and the idea of balance touches their heart, or the idea of getting back in touch with their divine feminine, if they're interested in Ayurveda or the Sophia Mission, what, especially, you know, Ayurveda, is it nationwide, or how can people learn more?
There's a lot you can find out online now, and I think, you know, we've seen, let me just back up if I might. Whenever we're in India and we're down at Maa Ganga, the river Ganges, I get so much what you were just saying about Yogananda. It feels to me very, and I'm not the first to say this, but you get a real felt perception of heaven dipping down to the tops of the Himalayas. You know, they're so tall that you can't see their tops. Mm-hmm. So it feels as if the tops of the mountains really are in heaven. Mm-hmm. And they're snow-capped, so they just reflect pure, beautiful white light. So then that white light melts and it becomes the river. So it does feel like Maa Ganga is carrying heaven or Shiva or infinite or immortal consciousness on her back. And her back, the river, sparkles with light. And as she flows down from the top of the mountains all the way to Varanasi at the other end of the river, people are saying, "I love you, Ma. Thank you, Ma." Mantra to the Divine Mother. So she carries that matrix, too, of that divine sound vibration. Mm. So she's got the light of Shiva she's carrying on her back. She's got this, you know, Shiva's intentions to create the world. And all of these great sages and their light and their intentions. And so where does, then you put yourself, you say, "Maa Ganga, please take me home. Please help me. Please heal me." Whatever your intentions and prayers are, she carries that where? All the way to the ocean. And of course the ocean is the symbol of immortality, right? So I think of Maa Ganga as the Divine Mother and as that river. And I think of it, as you said, that the flow is now coming all the way through and to the west coast of America. And one of the ways we're seeing that flow, if you think of a river as energy, is it's coming through the energy of Ayurvedic practitioners and doctors from India who are coming with their husbands or wives who have been brought over here to work in Silicon Valley or to work in Texas in industries that are, engineering or software. Same in Chicago, same in here in Sorrento Valley. So we are actually being peopled with this wisdom. And those people are, well, they're in the midst of a world that doesn't know too much about Ayurveda. So they're putting a lot of effort into educating the population. So actually, if you look on the website, on Google now or internet, you'll find both Ayurvedic doctors from India and a lot of us who have studied Ayurveda working to educate people about it. So there's a lot of free information, videos, articles, etc. So that's one way. There's some great books. I think Dr. Frawley is one of the greatest authors on Dr. Frawley or Vamadeva Shastri. A very, maybe not a simple book, but a very good starter book is his book Yoga and Ayurveda. But there's also more and more consultants. And, we can do phone consults. So my blog, I write a lot about what is Ayurveda, so that when I post a recipe, people can understand why the recipe has these various tastes. Right.
So, and this is your blog?
Foodalovestory.com.
Because we talk about Divine Mother and Food A Love Story. Tell us a little bit about Jyotish astrology. How is it, and I know you could do a whole series. By the way, she's going to be doing a whole series on the Divine Mother and healing that aspect within. So you can check the website that will be coming up after our talk. But how did you get born a Westerner, but you've kind of migrated and you do Jyotish astrology?
Right.
How did the, what's saying to you about it?
What sings to me is that we were born in the belly of a star. You know, I mean, that we could get high on that, right? That's, wow, that's trippy. But truly, if you're a scientist now and you want to understand the origins of existence, it's so fascinating that they, through microwave radiation and high-tech tools, are able to go back almost to the beginning of time through listening. But they can't go all the way back. And they say it's a Big Bang that started it all, but they can't actually be sure. And they can only go back to, and I'm making this up, but I'm going to say it's 2,500,000 years after what they think was the Big Bang. So they can get close, but they can't get back all the way. They say they bump into a wall. It's fascinating. But what they sort of ride the waves of sound vibration all the way back to this point where they can't go any further. So what was beyond? What did start it all? And how did it start, and why did it start? I mean, we have, you know, Paramahansa Yogananda. Why not believe what he tells us? Why not believe what the sages told us? Because we don't know, really. So it seems like, if you think about, in the beginning, there was nothing but vibration that they can hear now. At least they can hear it once it was 25,000 years old or so. But they can hear this vibration, right? So you figure, at that point, you have space and you have what we would call air in Ayurveda. We have movement, we have vibration. That vibration eventually, and it's just fluons and quarks and subatomic particles, but eventually, and they say there was a little bit of helium, but that starts to move, and movement creates friction. Friction creates heat. Before you know it, the helium particles rub up against each other, and they get so hot that they burst into flames, and a star is born. And in that star, helium converts to hydrogen, converts to oxygen, converts to carbon, eventually to iron. Not necessarily in that order, but eventually, as it converts, what's converted, the new particle, is heavier than and hotter than the last. So being heavier and hotter, it drops to the center of the star. And there it burns and gets even hotter. Boom, creates something else. But when I say that, helium, hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, iron, that's what we're made of, right? So when it's so hot that it ultimately explodes, it just throws everything out into the world. And eventually those things join together somewhere and make a planet, you know? And that planet has just the right ingredients to form life and eventually to form you and you and you and you and you and you and me, right? To do what? To remember that once upon a time we all lived together in the belly of a star and that we are made of light, right? And then when Ayurveda talks about what are the five elements, we don't just mean here on earth, plants and trees, but we had space and air and fire. Eventually fire creating hydrogen and oxygen, the elements of water, and eventually the components of earth, carbon, iron, etc. All there in the beginning, right? So Jyotish is understanding that, who we are in the cosmic picture. Why we're alive and what we're here to do, to know, and to be. So to understand that we have karmic patterns that may not exactly be our fault. I don't like the idea that, you know, you or I really did something bad in our past life. But there's some formation of some energetic patterns, matrix that's arisen in you. It's not necessarily to look at yourself as, I must have done something bad in my past life, that's why I'm suffering now. But rather to say, well, I carry this karmic pattern, what can I do to reduce it or even release myself from it? How can I maybe help others get out of myself a little bit? And in so doing, reduce that karmic load. But Jyotish helps us understand what the karma is that we're carrying, helps us understand the Dharma that we are living, what we're here to do, and how we can contribute and be our fullest and greatest expression. It understands us each as beings of light, as souls, as the true Atman, moving through time and space. And as an Atman moving through time and space, we pick up a little moss, a little dust, a little karma. But ultimately, it's teaching us who we are as a unique being of light. And I think in that way, it's very freeing. Mm-hmm. And it's also got remedies. You know, it's got yoga tools that we can offer once a person understands this period they might be going through in their life might be a sort of a heavy period. a period where they are living out some karma, well, we can look at that and offer some remedies. Because the most beautiful thing, too, is that we see the planets as devis, as divine beings, and they each reflect one of the rays of light and bounce that ray of light here into the earth. And so we see each individual as a servant of that devi. So we might be here to serve Mercury, carrying the emerald green ray of light. Or we might be here to serve Mars, you know, warrior of peace. As Gandhi said, a soldier of peace. So we're each serving a devi. And it's beautiful to look at your Jyotish part and chart and understand who you're here to serve. And then to say, from now on, every day forward, I wake up, I do my mantra to tune into that devi, and I offer myself, devi, divine goddess, divine masculine, divine one, how do I serve you today? So Jyotish is a reminder that we're children of God and we're here to serve the light. It's very, very beautiful.
That's
great. Yeah.
Wow.
Such a storyteller. I mean, right. You know what I mean? Right,
that's why when you asked me, I said, I hope I don't go on too much.
Well, that was worth every moment of it.
Yeah. Really of a star.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I can see how, you know, you were in that Saraswati community and had a little time. And you did all these things, but what I don't understand is how you can be in 2012 and doing Ayurveda and teaching a master teacher, and then on top of this, and this is another thing you'll find on the website, she presented these as gifts, and Tom and I are always perfecting our diets, you know, we're always trying to raise our vibration through awareness and health and food and that sort of thing. Mm. So these are gifts of Laura's, and you'll see them on the website, right? So on top of everything else that she does, she creates food. And, tell us about this one.
It's just like anybody who at some point needs to play a little bit with, you know, it's like we need to come out of our heads at some point and play with the paints if we're a painter, or do our yoga, just an embodied form of the wisdom. So that is something, actually Bhava gave it the name, he calls it the Mahashakti, detox protein powder, because it's got a lot of that Shakti wisdom in it. It's green, so it's chlorella and spirulina. I also add a little ground dandelion, dried dandelion, and milk thistle. It's got 5 different Ayurvedic herbs and turmeric. I also add cardamom, cinnamon, and fennel that helps with digestion. Yum. It's got sprouted organic rice protein powder and a plant form of lecithin, teeny, teeny bit of psyllium fiber, and probably some other things I'm forgetting. But it's designed to simultaneously, and this is a true gift of Ayurveda, we can simultaneously nourish a body while we're detoxifying. Because detoxifying can be a little bit of a shock to the system, and it can cause a lot of emotional releases as well. So if we can hold a person and lovingly nourish them while detoxifying, then we create a more efficient system.
Wow. Have you created blends for things like menopause or women to bring their bodies back into balance after childbirth and that sort of thing?
You know, I'm starting to look at that. I have created oils, I mentioned that. And I have a vata-reducing, pitta-reducing, and kapha-reducing oil. And I'm about to rename them. Nourish, something like nourish, chill, and energize or something. So the vata-reducing one is very nourishing. And the Ayurveda offers a very simple remedy for women, let's say, early to mid-40s. Just as you start to transition, focus on internal and external oleation, which means every morning you wake up, you cover your body in oil. And the oil that I've created, the nourishing oil, vata reducing, would be the one. But it's primarily sesame oil, an organic, not toasted sesame oil. You can buy it even at a good food store. Sesame oil, you could just get that. You know, I add certain herbs that are especially beneficial and really good for women because they balance women's hormonal system. But first thing in the morning, you cover yourself in oil, head to toe, everything, especially the joints. Don't forget your head. And then you wait 15, 20 minutes. Get in the shower. Before you actually go under, you let the heat of the shower open your pores. It drives the oil a little deeper into your tissues. And then you wash it off. So after you come out of the shower, you don't have oil that won't mess up your clothes. But it's gone into your system, so it will hydrate you. And that's the key thing for women at that phase. Mm-hmm. They're moving from a fire phase to an air phase. And that means we're starting to dry out a little bit. And the fire that's usually contained in the belly has started to move throughout the body. It's almost like air getting into a fire and whipping it up. So suddenly you get the hot flashes and things. The air gets a little loose from its core. But what grounds fire? If you put fire in a container and surround it by water, it couldn't go anywhere. It stays contained and grounded. So oil is a water element. We consider that a water element. So oil inside and out. Mm. Little bit of ghee in your tea in the morning.
Really?
Or just hot water, lemon, and a little bit of ghee. So on an empty system, you lubricate the digestive tract. It's internal and external oleation. It's so powerful. And you can do the other things too, more grounding, root vegetables, some warming spices. But it's the oleation that'll make a big difference. Mm. And you know, it's nourishing. It's more nourishment from the Divine Mother. Mm-hmm. It's all about her love, really. Like you said, she's what keeps us strong in body, right? Mm-hmm. She's constantly loving us so that we can do our practice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, thank you so much.
Will you be, and as you speak, and it's such a great voice in such a great way, will you be doing CDs or meditations to connect with the Divine Mother?
The Divine Mother Healing is an 8-month course where each month there's going to be a guided visualization, about 30 minutes. And all you have to do is lie down and relax or sit in one of these comfortable chairs and put your head back. And just listen and let yourself be guided back to the heart of the Mother and allow healing to happen. So each month it'll be a different one. There'll be regular emails to remind you that you're loved, that you're a divine child. And then we'll also have a monthly call where we all get together. And again, what I love so much about what you've done here is creating community. Because, and again, it's Yogananda who said it, it's, you know, it's that second coming of Christ, you know, that's going to happen where we all gather together. And I find that with women, too, when women gather together, there's so much wisdom. Mm. And we don't need a star teacher, we don't need a star celebrity woman empowerment healer, that's great to have, but every woman has, everybody has the wisdom within. Mm. But I think that's what it's about to be celebrating and cultivating the Divine Feminine, is to recognize the wisdom we already have within us. So we'll have a call that will encourage that.
Well, that's basically what the series is. Can people get information
on lauraplum.com? On lauraplum.com you can find, and I will put information up there. I've already, on the Sophia Mission, started to put up. So there's sophiamission.com, which is where that's going to be based, sophiamission.com. But it'll be linked to lauraplum.com, it'll be linked to deepyoga.com. It'll all be interconnected.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm. Well, thank
so thank you. Thank you both so much for what you do.
Wow.
You're great, 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 sparkling, shiny, broad, beautiful beacons of light in our community. Phenomenal work you're doing, really. We are so grateful for you. Thank you for flowing
into our consciousness tonight. And it's
thank you.
Been
and
an evening with Divine Mother. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. I so appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, and thank you for coming. Thank you.